Changing gears in a conventional gearbox is a time-consuming process that wastes a lot of lap time. You need to use the clutch, back off the throttle, change gears, release the clutch, and then get back on the throttle. With a proper motorsport dog engagement sequential gearbox, things are a little bit different, and generally these can be shifted without using the clutch. But there's a bit that goes into this. We're here with Scott from Haltech to talk about the setup that he's just implemented on Mike Burroughs Stanceworks Honda turbo-powered Ferrari. And that is a big mouthful. Yeah. All right, let's not worry too much about the specifics of the car. I'm interested in the gearbox control. So for a start, what is the gearbox fitted to the car?
Okay, so this has got a Quaife 5-speed dog box in it. It's got a load cell gear knob, and it's got a position sensor on the shift shaft for the gearbox, so we know what gear it's in.
Okay. This is going to be a little difficult to do without diagrams right in front of us, but can you give us a bit of an understanding on what the process is for a shift to take place with a dog engagement gearbox and why we don't necessarily need to use the clutch like we do in a factory synchro mesh style gearbox?
For sure. So basically what's happening there is in a dog style engagement gearbox, we've got basically our two teeth that need to either engage or disengage. There's no synchro mesh. So what's happening is we need to take the power off the gearbox. So basically when we're driving, the two teeth are engage like this. As we disengage the power, the teeth will go loose. That'll allow us to get the next gear, then engage the power again. So there's a bit of magic there in making sure that we do engage the next gear correctly, as well as cutting the correct amount of power to disengage those gears. If we cut too much power, we'll actually get stuck on the trailing edge of those teeth. If we don't cut enough power, you can't physically pull it out of the gear. So we want to make it nice and smooth to pull out of the gear.
Let's move back one step before we talk about the electronic element of controlling these gear shifts. And conventionally, if we didn't have an ECU or we weren't running gear shift control, the general process is that the driver will be at full throttle, looking for an upshift, get to the shift light and apply some force onto the gear lever to preload the dogs. And then all that's required is like a little lift on the throttle to disengage the gear, and the shifter just pulls right through. It's really, really seamless, and you don't need to lift right out of the throttle. So it results in very, very fast shifts without the need to use the clutch. But we've still got that slight torque reduction to allow the shift to occur. All right, so let's talk about electronic integration there. How is that being controlled in the Haltech ECU?
So we've got two different things happening. We've got the load cell gear knob. So as soon as the driver pulls on the load cell gear knob, that's activating our shift so that we know something's happening. We've got a forwards and backwards shift on the sequential gearbox in this particular car so that we know whether it's an upshift or a downshift. So once we hit that, that initializes our cut and something start. We choose a percentage of cut there. So typically if we said 80 or 90% cut, which is enough to reduce the engine power, like you're talking about, just sort of like lifting off the throttle. We're then looking at the shift shaft position as well from the gear position sensor on the gearbox. We call that either, so a timed style cut would be hit the gear knob, it will cut engine power for X amount of milliseconds, then reintroduce the power.
In this instance, though, you're actually running what's referred to as closed loop gear change control. So it's not a specific time cut. It's actually looking at that gearbox position sensor, and it knows when that next gear is engaged. So the cut is only as long as it needs to be.
Brilliant. So it does, it actually has a time cut at the end of that as well, interestingly. So what we do there is once we've hit the gear knob, we know that, so we initiate that cut, it shifts into the next gear. We then hold the cut for X amount of time. In this car, it's 10 milliseconds. So make sure it's truly in that next gear, then we release that cut.
Let's talk a little bit about the cut itself. We've already talked about the fact we need a reduction in torque to allow the dogs to disengage. But there's two ways we can do this. Well, three ways, really. We could lift off the throttle, which we've already talked about. We don't really want to do that if we don't need to. Then we've got the option to cut fuel or cut spark or cut both.
Yep.
Pros and cons of those options?
I like to cut both because while the bang is really fun between the gears and it's exciting and it's nice, it does load up the valve train a fair bit, so the exhaust valve stuff. So personally, I like to cut both. Some people I see choose to cut just ignition. And then there's also that option of once you reintroduce the power, how to reintroduce the power. So whether we've got a retard as a reintroduction or whether it's an instant recovery. This car does an instant recovery because it's happy with that. Some cars like to feed the ignition timing back in over, say, 10 or 20 milliseconds after the cut has been released.
Okay, there's a couple of bits I just want to dive into in a little bit more detail there. So first of all, you mentioned the effect on the valve train, and probably most people have heard motorsport sequential gearboxes, and every time the driver shifts up, there's a nice pop out the exhaust. As you mentioned, sounds great. The problem is that this can be hard on the valve train, and we also need to be mindful with some types of valve train. This can end up popping rockers off. SR20 would be a good example.
SR20? Why SR20? Just, there's nothing more to say. If you do an ignition-only upshift on an SR20, yeah, good chance are something's going to end up in the sump and you're driving back on three cylinders. Even on an engine that is not so prone to that, you are reducing the life of the engine. And by the time that you do have a sequential gearbox in a car, odds are it's a pretty highly strung, pretty high powered engine with huge cylinder pressures. It's most certainly going to have custom camshafts. It's going to have huge valve springs. So whatever you can do to stop that bouncing on the camshaft, the better.
I'll just quickly talk about the mechanics or what's going on behind that for those who maybe aren't aware. So with an ignition-only car, basically we're doing that. We're stopping the spark on a cylinder, but we've still got a cylinder's full of fuel and air. It's going to pass through unburned, and then it's going to generally ignite and explode in the exhaust manifold, which gives that nice-sounding pop. But then that creates a pressure spike, which can pop that exhaust valve back off the seat. In turn, we lose control of the camshaft, directly controlling the valve, and then all sorts of ugly stuff happens. So I'm with you. I prefer either a fuel car or fuel and spark. It is by far the easiest on the engine. All right, let's just get back into that recovery. So you mentioned that you've got the ability to retard the ignition timing, which reduces torque, and then feed that back in over 10 milliseconds or 50 milliseconds or whatever you choose. So how did you decide on that? You mentioned that the Ferrari doesn't really need that. You've got an instantaneous reintroduction of torque. Obviously, ideally, that's going to be faster, but it can also upset the car. So how do you decide as a tuner what the car needs?
So of that, a lot of that, to be honest, is the feel of it. So the first, typically what I would try and do is start to use that flat shift on the dyno. Yep. So on a normal roller style dyno, get a feel for when the thing re-engages, whether it's bucking and whether it can accept that power, or whether there's something weird going on where we've got an airflow problem after the cut, where it wants to have a retard to come back in smoothly, which I would normally start with, and then lower and lower that retard. And if it simply doesn't want it and it can recover immediately at a really good mixture, we just keep going and then come out to the track to then do the final testing at the track, because we've got the inertia of the car behind us and we've got the track conditions.
All right. Also, let's talk about the downshift. We've so far been concentrating on the upshift. Yeah. You mentioned that that load cell, the ECU knows, depending on whether the driver's pushing the gear stick forward or back, whether he's requesting an upshift or a downshift. Yeah. So on the downshift, things are a little bit more complex because we need to actually rev match. We need to bring the engine speed up to match what it's going to be in the next lowest gear. So we can manually do that, obviously, by blipping the throttle, using the clutch, or with drive-by-wire throttle, this can be done by the ECU. So how's it been done in the Ferrari?
So we do a downshift throttle blip in this as well. So a little bit more expensive if you mess it up on the downshift. So what's happening there is if we do perform a downshift, we're going to hold that rhythm. So we're going to do a rev match limiter. So we're looking at the gear ratios so we know what engine RPM it's going to go to in the lower gear. So the blade is going to open to that particular RPM or to try and target that RPM. Then it's going to cut. It's going to get us back into the lower gear, re-engage, and we should do a rev match, very similar to exactly what you're talking about, to do a throttle blip rev match.
Now, the next question that comes up is reliability in terms of maintenance and servicing on a dog engagement gearbox. And this can be quite variable depending on the driving style. Because if we don't get these shifts quite right, we end up wearing these dogs. And at some point, the dog wear gets so bad that it just jumps out of gear. Obviously, not what we want. With a properly set up closed-loop shift strategy like this, are we likely to get better results in terms of gearbox reliability and life expectancy than manually shifting?
Yeah, 100%. So remembering that there's one thing here, this still does have a gear lever. It's not fully paddle shifted. So the only thing we don't have control over is the driver pulling on that shifter. And I always say that the harder you pull on it, the less it's going to cost.
Yeah, I think it's one of those elements where mechanical sympathy kind of goes out the window. And yeah, as you say, the harder you pull on that lever, the better the gearbox is going to last.
And likewise, when you go to a full paddle shifted, full automatic system, we're going to get more life out of the gearbox because those pneumatic solenoids, or however they're working, they've got no sympathy. You hit that button, it smashes it. It'll do the cut. It'll smash it into the gear, and it'll be every time consistent.
So the more we can get the driver out of the equation there, the better it is for the gearbox.
Yeah, but less for the viewers, I suppose. So, but look, on these, you should expect a really long sort of life cycle out of a gearbox that is well set up, as long as the driver's pulling on that gear lever correctly.
Last question, and I this is going to be very dependent on the specific gearbox and a lot to do with the setup, but could you give us some insight into how long a typical upshift is in terms of milliseconds?
This thing this morning is doing about 57 milliseconds, somewhere around there. So he's fairly fresh in the car as well. So there were some that were sort of 65, 68. So say about 57 seemed to be about where it wants to be. So that's 47 milliseconds in the actual shifting event. Then the ECU holding it for another 10 milliseconds to make sure it's truly in the gear. By the end of the weekend, I might try and lower that a little bit. But at the moment, the G sensors aren't showing that it's nosing over. The data looks like it's really, really good, and it looks really good on the track as well, which is important as well, to be watching it on the track to see what it's doing.
Perfect. Look, great to get some insight into that, and hopefully for our viewers, that explains a little bit more about the gear shift strategies. Thanks, Scott.
Mate, always a pleasure.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.